difference between here and Hawaii. So fast asleep in bed right now. So this work that I'm going to talk about is, we've gone from very finished, published, to data behind it, to very theoretical, in this case, this afternoon. But it's pretty exciting. It's a collaboration between Nilsen and Rachel and myself, as well as many of the folks in this room and many other people around the world. So what we'd like to do, and what we've proposed to do, what we are doing, is to model leakage from zero deforestation commitments in South American soybean sector. And also, I'm only going to talk about soy today, but we're also trying to do this with cattle in South America and with oil palm in Southeast Asia. So we've had a great introduction to zero deforestation commitments already today, but just to review real quick, in terms of soy, actually the number of zero deforestation commitments is quite small in comparison to, say, palm or the timber and pulp sectors. Nevertheless, the number has grown substantially in recent years. And these commitments are highly variable. They're highly lauded by NGOs and even these companies, right, that have made them. But whether they're having an impact on the ground is questionable. Of course, we have the soy moratorium, which is probably the most well-known set of zero deforestation commitments. But there's a whole set of other ones that Eric has referred to that we're trying to compile here to understand. And so the first step in this project actually is being led by Rachel and Sam, who's a PhD student in her lab. And what we're doing is compiling a set of information on all of these individual commitments. So if you're Cargill, if you're ADM, if you're L'Oreal, you've made some kind of commitment to reducing deforestation. And so I just pulled a couple of these to so you could understand kind of what the variability in these is. This one is ADM. So some of them are very broad and non-specific, and some of them are quite specific. So for instance, ADM says they're going to comply with the soy moratorium and have a traceable soy supply chain that does not contribute to deforestation. Sounds great, right? They also say that they're going to comply with several other specific policies in South America and have a whole set of oil palm commitments as well. L'Oreal is actually quite specific in terms of their timeline and how they're actually going to implement the commitment. So for instance, they say they're dealing with sustainably sourced soy oil, I assume this is RTRS, and that they have set a deadline for themselves of 2020. So very few or many of these commitments don't come with any sort of timeline, but was what we found. So that's one thing of note. And then there's high specificity in some of these commitments. So some of them actually specify which instruments they're using to define forests. So for instance, McDonald's is talking about no deforestation of primary forests, areas with high conservation value, that's basically taken from RSPO language, and then no development of high carbon stock areas. And if you're not aware of the high carbon stock approach, it's now being implemented in the oil palm sector, but it might be translated to other parts of the world and other commodities. And it's, in fact, has nothing to do with carbon stocks, but happy to talk about that later. It's much more about forest structure. So so we're trying to understand what these commitments look like so that we can actually implement them and play with them in models and different scenarios of commitments. And so in this project, we're asking kind of a big overarching question, which is, under what conditions might these supply chain commitments actually lead to conservation of natural ecosystems? And hopefully this gets to Javier's point that, you know, maybe it's actually hard to prove causality in many of these cases, but in a modeling framework, we have control, right? And so we're not here trying to do empirical work. We're really trying to use empirical information about these actors and about these commitments, make some assumptions about implementation, and then play with the system to understand how leakage and spillover effects might happen within that system. And so we're doing three things. We're saying, how are these zero deforestation commitments likely to affect agricultural rents? That's already been talked about a bit today by Jan. How might changes in rents, implementation timelines, and forest definitions influence land cover? So this is kind of the more scenario side of things where we're looking at how these different zero deforestation commitments are going to affect our land cover. And then how much avoided deforestation from commitments, if any, but we'll assume that there is some, might be offset by leakage across commodities and biomes, which is perhaps the most interest to this group, but of course we're the farthest away from that, that particular answer. So to tackle this first question really quickly, we're doing a bunch of field work starting in this summer to understand this question about rents. And where we're working for the field work and also for this project as a whole is what we're calling BBOP, which is Bolivia, Brazil, Argentina, and Paraguay. We're excluding Uruguay because I guess Bibapu is not a very nice acronym. also because they have less data. But So as everybody knows, there's a lot of conversion of natural vegetation to agriculture here. We have to work across multiple biomes, which is interesting. There's high data availability and a diversity of forest governance context. So all of these, this diversity will allow us to kind of play with the model in different ways to understand leakage within the region and then hopefully eventually globally, as I'll be talking about in a second. So in terms of these rents or agricultural rents or profits that farmers are facing, Sam and others will be going out into the field and designing some field work to get at this. We're looking at, of course, our net price that farmers are facing times yield, which is the land rent. And that net price will be the output price at the port, and then the transport cost to the port, the production cost, which will include things like labor and inputs, and then the compliance cost. And this last part is what we're most interested in quantifying in our interviews and in our field work. And so we've theorized, and I would love to get your feedback on this, I think Rachel and Nelson would as well, that there's both a cost of compliance with these zero deforestation commitments as well as a cost of non-compliance. And that cost of compliance could be things like auditing that ensures and proves that you are not deforesting. Maybe it's mapping the boundaries of your land holding. There's several other things that could cost you when you're trying to prove that you're not deforesting. The opportunity cost of not converting forests. And maybe the increase in price of previously converted land. Right, so those, if it becomes more valuable, if you can only expand into pasture, that might drive up the price of pasture. So we're hoping to quantify those things. And then the cost of non-compliance, market exclusion, perhaps you can't sell to everybody who's buying in a municipio. Credit restrictions, especially in the case of government regulations that are going along with these zero deforestation commitments, there could be restrictions on credit. And as Holly Gibbs and her group and some others have found, there could be substantial costs of laundering, right? If you have to sell your product through sort of a gray supply chain, that might be costly to you. So that's the first part of the project. Again, it's very theoretical, but this is what we're hoping to do. And imagine, in a year or two, we'll have a good sense of, at least in large regions of South America, an understanding of these, essentially these compliance costs, as well as these other inputs to the model. And with that, then, we want to model how changes in rents, so how zero deforestation commitments and their impacts on rents, and the commitments themselves in terms of implementation timelines, forest definitions, et cetera, influence land cover. So this is where we're actually creating a land use change model in Dynamica Ego. And I have to say, this is kind of the strangest talk that I've given in a long time because I don't work in South America myself. And the creator of Dynamica is sitting there, and we've got the creator of GTAP here. So this is like, what's that? Like, serious imposter syndrome, but here we go. So we have this land use change model, and we're using data from Jordan Gracer, who's at Boston University. It's annual MODIS-derived pasture, cropland, and several other land covers. And we're pretty excited about it, actually. So that will be the input to the spatial model. And then Dynamica often does partition change into two different things. We look at quantity of change, and we look at location of change, right? So the quantity of change will be econometrically estimated, looking at land cover change as a function of land rents and several other control variables. So we're trying to make this model as not very deterministic. We don't want to, especially since we're trying to simulate leakage, ensure that there will be leakage just by the way that we design the model. So we're trying to be very careful about this. The second thing we'll be doing is looking at location of change, and this is through transition probability maps, right? So we can actually look at where changes happened in the past and understand what the spatial predictors of that change are. So that's a little bit less difficult in terms of the deterministic nature of the model. And then in addition to that, we're going to, in terms of the land use change component, we're going to include suitability restrictions and other key spatial and non-spatial variables. So we're doing a huge effort to collect all of the supply chain data that we possibly can to put it into the model. So ports and roads and potentially silos, although apparently Rachel doesn't think silos are a big deal, and other things that are critical for actually getting that soy to market, and which are owned or controlled by these big corporations that have made these commitments, like Cargill and ADM. So that's what the land change model will look like in terms of the spatial side. In addition to the spatial information, we're also including data from Trace. And these data are fantastic because we can actually say within each municipality who is buying the soy from there in every year, and then how much of that total soy production is actually covered by one of these commitments, right? So we can say in municipality X, we see that 50% of the soy sourced from that region is sourced by Cargill, and therefore it's covered under Cargill's zero deforestation commitment. So that's pretty cool. How we actually do this in the model is kind of still up for design. we're talking about this. We had a great meeting last spring where we hammered out some of these details, but they're still theoretical and not actually implemented. So we're talking about two different options. First is sort of a moderate complexity option, that I'm calling it, which is where we'll actually modify the spatial distribution of land rents based on quantity and region-specific conversion and compliance costs. So to illustrate, if we have pasture and we have forest, and either of these could be converted to soy, maybe this is the land rent upon conversion to soy. There's no zero deforestation commitments in the region and time equals one. Time equals two, we do see a company that has come into the region that starts sourcing soy, and that reduces everybody's land rent in some way based on our understanding of those compliance costs, right? So this is one simpler way to deal with it. A second option would actually be to model company sourcing behavior. And this is where things get really complex. And also the supply chain infrastructure changes that would actually support that company sourcing behavior. And in order to do this, we might have region one with that same pasture and forest. Region two has only pasture, so maybe it's better in terms of if you're a company that wants to expand, this might be more desirable. And so a company will just simply, instead of sourcing from here, they choose to go into region two. So you don't see any impact on land rents in region one, and where that company has moved into, you do see an impact on land rents because of these compliance costs. How we actually model that company sourcing behavior and those changes is not determined or to be determined. But this is how we'll implement it, we believe, in terms of the spatial allocation of these rents. So the third question then is how much of water deforestation from these commitments might be offset by leakage across commodities and biomes. So far we've been dealing with regional scale leakage and land use change. And in the Dynamica model, of course, we have these commitments, we have a bunch of input data, we are modeling land rents, land use change, and potentially regional leakage, right? And with that, we're understanding soy bean area. In the coupled model, so we're actually coupling Dynamica with GTAP AEZ, or agroecological zones. So in this coupled model, what we've determined, and again, this is to be implemented, but we believe we can do it, GTAP will give Dynamica a price. Dynamica will run for about 5 years annually, right? So Dynamica is probably best to simulate land use change on an annual scale because that's the scale at which people are thinking about land use decisions. GTAP, on the other hand, wouldn't make sense on an annual scale. 5 years is probably pushing it. So Dynamica will run, and then it will produce this area, right, of soy, as well as soy yields. And our yields in this case could actually be affected by inputs like climate, technology. We can maybe modify this model once we have it set up. With the yield and area, we get production. And then GTAP will take that production from our these regions of interest, these are agroecological zones in South America, and it will reallocate supply and demand in order to balance any shortcomings or overproduction from that region based on what it was expecting. And then it will pass Dynamica back that new price. If I've butchered any of that, please, Nelson, correct my description. So, and in GTAP, of course, we can then understand this global leakage right across our agroecological zones. And in this case, we are able to overlay the agroecological zones on the country, so we do get sort of a subnational, though not spatialized, understanding of where that leakage is going. And we also can understand where it's going in terms of other types of crops, right? Whether it's oil palm or something else. So yeah, so that's our coupled model. This is what we're planning to do. In terms of our scenarios, we can look at population, incomes, and preferences in GTAP, modifying zero deforestation commitments in Dynamica, playing with climate and technologies, and then maybe modifying yields as well. In terms of our scenarios, this is what we're thinking. We had a big meeting last fall at about this time with some of the people in this room to brainstorm some of these. There was actually, as has been brought up in this room today, quite a lot of focus on domestic demand, so that's of interest. But beyond that, we're trying to understand what the impact of the location of commitment adoption is on leakage and land cover change. So perhaps there's greater reductions in regions where policies already discourage deforestation, such as in the Brazilian Amazon. The definition of deforestation is huge, obviously, whether you're dealing with HCV, HCS forest, or maybe a zero net or zero gross type of commitment, right? So the zero net commitments, which about a third of the soybean companies that we've studied have, basically say that if you allow forests to regrow here, you can deforest over here. So it's really not about forest conservation or preservation. Adoption timelines. So as we know, a lot of these companies don't actually have timelines. So we'll have to kind of simulate that in some way or another. But we can also look at, in our scenarios, whether more near-term or long-term commitments make a difference. Obviously, near-term commitments will probably preserve more forest than future ones. And then finally, yields. And a lot of the work that's coming out of South America shows that both soy yields and cattle yields and double cropping are really critical in all of these land use change decisions. And so we'll have to think about this as well. So advances that we hope the work will make, and enhance the empirical understanding of spatial relationships between the land cover change actor-specific soy flows and zero deforestation commitments. So that will largely be from the work that Sam is doing to understand where these commitments are being implemented and then where this deforestation is occurring. And the second one will be enhanced theoretical understanding of enabling conditions for effective zero deforestation commitments. And even though this is theoretical, we really do hope that it will inform NGOs, companies, and governments about maybe what the best ways, if they're interested in reducing deforestation, are to actually go about doing that, right? So it's very much applied research in that sense. And then with CSYNC, we're funded by the Social Environmental Synthesis Center. We're hoping to build a user-friendly modeling tool that can actually be used by companies to assess how their own commitments will maybe affect deforestation locally and globally. Well, that's probably a few years out to get to there. So a big thanks to everybody, and I'm happy to take any questions.